Baldwin Park, in California,
Los Angeles, een van de belangrijkste muzieksteden van de wereld. Er zitten hier honderden opnamestudio's en er wonen duizenden muzikanten. Na de filmindustrie is de muziekindustrie hier de grootste. Er zit hier heel veel muziek in de lucht. Dat merk je als je bijvoorbeeld probeert te zoeken naar een van de vele tientallen radiostations die in deze enorme stad te vinden zijn. Het is dé manier om erachter te komen wat voor smeltkroes van culturen deze stad eigenlijk is. In de jaren 50 begonnen hier doo-wopgroepen als de Platters en de Coasters. Deze kustlijn diende ook als inspiratiebron voor de schijnbaar zorgeloze surfmuziek van de Beach Boys en Jan en Dean. Halverwege de jaren 60 barstte het pas echt los toen de Byrds onder aanvoering van David Crosby en Roger McGuinn een grote hit kregen met het Bob Dylan nummer Mr. Tambourine Man. Dat was het startsein voor bands als Mama's and the Papa's, Turtles en iets later voor The Doors, Love, Frank Zappa and the Mothers of Invention en Buffalo Springfield. Het was vooral de prachtige samenzang die opviel. Het handelsmerk van deze groep. En een traditie die werd doorgezet door latere acts als The Eagles, Poco, Jackson Browne en Crosby, Stills, Nash en Young. Vorig jaar verscheen vrij onverwacht het album Born and Raised van een band genaamd Venice. Muziek die eigenlijk naadloos aansluit op het beste van groepen als Eagles, Poco, Crosby, Stills en Nash en The Byrds.
I don't really remember who told me first about Venice. I think it might have been my friend David Bender. I'm not sure. It might have been Jackson. Someone did, and then I went and heard them live, and they just floored me. You know, I'm a student of harmony. That's my thing. I love vocal harmony, and I always have. It was my strong suit in the Byrds, and it was, you know, the major contribution that I could make to Crosby, Stills, and Nash. And I love it. I love all kinds of harmony, but I particularly love theirs. Because it's so natural, you know, it's not like anybody else. It's very unforced, very, very from their hearts, and they just completely blew my mind.
Losing faith, and it makes me sad. When I think of losing more, well, it makes me mad. Losing beauty. Brings me down, and with everything we've gained, we're losing ground. Well, every time I turn another corner, seems that someone else is doing wrong. And every time I jump into the water, seems there's something there that don't belong. When it feels like the end of the world, my dear, well, I need you. It feels like the end of the world, my love. Will you help me rise? Ooh, rise above. No more father, no more son. No more running from the man that I've become. Too much freedom, but nothing's free. So I try to make some sense of what's to be. Because every day I wake up and I wonder how a blessing could become a curse, yeah. And every night I
pray it's getting better, but I find it's only getting worse. When it feels like the end of the world, my dear, I need you here. When it feels like the end of the world, my love, will you help me rise above?
Oh, they can sing you, you know, note for note, Stevie Wonder songs and any number of really great R&B singers, whatever gets on the radio. So it's that and more, you know? It's that tradition and an element of their own, which comes from being, I think it comes from being family and from being able to sing anything that they hear.
Well, every time I turn another corner, seems that someone else is doing wrong. And every time I jump into the water, seems there's something there that don't belong. When it feels like the end of the world, my dear, well, I need you here. When it feels like the end of the world, my love, will you help me rise above? Sometimes it feels like the end of the world. Oh, here comes the end. Oh, my dear, help, I need to have you near. When it feels like the end of the world, my love, will you help me rise above?
Venice vernoemde zichzelf naar deze plek, de thuisbasis van de groep waar ze wonen en werken. En dat is niet zo gek, want ze zijn familie van elkaar. Pat, Michael, Mark en Kip zijn afkomstig uit het geslacht Lennon. Aan het begin van deze eeuw had een journalist, Bert Lennon, een interview met een Duitse danseres, Betty Heinrich. Ze trouwden met elkaar en gingen hier wonen, op Venice Beach. Ze kregen 8 kinderen en inmiddels kent het geslacht Lennon 200 nakomelingen, stuk voor stuk, afkomstig van mensen die mekaars taal geen eens spraken.
From the first time I saw you, or I guess that I should say, from the first time I saw you look at me, it was there. On your face you saw me not just as I am, but the way I've always wanted to be. Ooh. What I felt there and then,
I feel here and now.
And I know I'll do anything I can to be what you see. I wanna be the man you think I am. Ooh. I wanna be the man you think I am. Yeah, I wanna be the man. I wanna be the man you think I am, think I am. From the first time I held you, or I guess that I should say, from the first time I felt your hold on me, I was lost, I was found. Yeah, you turned me upside down in a way I've always wanted to be. And what I felt there and then,
I feel here and now.
And it feels like you've given me a card to get out of jail free. I wanna be the man you think I am. Ooh.
I wanna be the man you think I am. I wanna be the man you think I am.
should say, from the first time I saw you look at me.
De droom van de bedenker en oprichter van het Ocean Park op Venice Beach, Abbot Kinney, werd in 1904 verwezenlijkt. Wat hij wilde was een Coney Island aan de westkust, geïnspireerd op de Italiaanse stad Venetië. De grond was goedkoop, het klimaat het hele jaar goed. Hij liet kanalen graven waar de bezoeker een gondel kon huren. En er werden casino's, een pier, restaurants en een pretpark aangelegd. Dit Ocean Park werd een bijzonder gewilde bestemming. Ook voor grootvader Burt, die daar met zijn Betty in 1917 kwam wonen. Hun zoons waren muzikaal en ze richtten de Lennon Brothers op, waar ze dit soort liedjes mee zongen.
There's a touch of Mexico. Cactus lovelier than orchids, blooming in the patio.
Soft strung guitar makes the night seem so sweet, makes everything work a lot.
In my adobe hacienda, there's a touch of Mexico.
Strung guitar makes the night seem so sweet, makes every evening work a lot.
Three beat babosas all
in my adobe hacienda. Life and love are more complete. Life and love are more complete.
Yeah. Little man, stop playing. Time your day was through.
Een ander deel van de familie, de Lennon Sisters, trad jarenlang op in de populaire Lawrence Welk Show, waar ook Pat en Kip als kleine kinderen al hun liedjes zongen, samen met hun neefjes en nichtjes.
Boy, the first time I sang, I must have been a baby, so I wouldn't even remember. I mean, my family was on doing television and things like that since I was a little boy, so, because my sisters, you know, as you know, were famous back in the 50s and 60s on television and stuff, so we would always do things, you know, I was a little boy. But I think the first time I really started singing again as I got older was when I sang with Michael. Michael and I had a band, like, when we were like, oh, I don't know, 12, something like that. And I think we knew three songs. We knew Born on the Bayou, you know, a John Fogerty song. And we knew Me and Julio Down by the Schoolyard. And we knew, I think, half of Let It Be. That's about it.
I read in the paper there were robbers with flashlights that shine in the dark. My love needs a doggy to protect her.
I grew up listening to the Lennon Sisters actually when I was real small. That, you know, my sisters are famous singers in the United States. And they were our first influences, but that was a lot because of harmonies. We would actually travel from place to place. We had 11 in my family, and we'd travel. And my dad would give us all different parts to sing. There'd be like nine of us in the car or something, and he'd give us all different parts, and we'd sing. So that was my first influences, because we'd put on the radio, and he would say, you sing the low part, you sing the high part, you sing the medium part, let's see what we can get going here. And we'd all sing, and it was great. So first influence, I think, was really with harmonies. Mm-hmm. And then later on, growing up, like in the 60s, I guess, there were a lot of people that started playing down at the beach, and I take my guitar down there and just play and sing, and not for anything professionally or anything, just playing.
We would always do like little family shows, you know, in my family. We would, you know, I would sit down, my older brother and sisters and my mom, mother and father, whoever was home and not going out on dates or whatever, would sit them home and I would put on my favorite record and sing along with it. You know, it was before karaoke, so you couldn't take out the vocal, you had to sing along with it. So I was always singing with the Jackson 5 and with Jefferson Starship. I remember Miracles, If Only You Believe in Miracles. That was one of my favorite songs that I used to love to sing along with. And I was so young and I could hit all the high notes. And so we'd put on shows and stuff. And so they were always receptive and said, good job, you know. So that was my influence and my experience and my encouragement.
We've been working as a band together about 20 to 22 years, in, you know, in a small form, and then just building this and building it and to where we are now, you know. And so that the vocal part is the easiest part for us. It's the musical arrangements and things that we have trouble with, you know.
Zonder al te veel speurwerk zijn de sporen uit het verleden nog terug te vinden in de architectuur van dit gebied. En de Lennons wonen nog altijd in Venice Beach. Ondanks de grote veranderingen en het toerisme houden ze van deze plek. Zoals de doorsnee Amsterdammer van de Jordaan.
We maken een bigger one.
Let's see.
Oh, you
like a baseball player. Did he?
Yeah. Thank you.
There you go.
Cheap sunglasses.
And we've done shows down here. This is called the Venice Pavilion.
Venice Pavilion.
It's kind of famous because it's covered with graffiti.
Janis Joplin there when I was 5 years old or 6 years old. When my older brother and sisters, we took them down there. There's a stage, lots of graffiti and tables. It's really, really cool. And like a year ago, they painted all over the graffiti. They painted it all gray. It was terrible. And then like within like 2 months, all the graffiti came back.
It's back
really
again.
Beautiful, colorful.
You gotta see it. It's pretty cool. I know they filmed the Doors movie down here because this is where the Doors used to hang out so much. And we've done a show down here. They set us up for some festival thing.
Yeah, it was Heal the Bay.
Yeah, the thing for the ocean.
We played on the same stage as Janis Joplin.
Thank you so much. Right, that's the stage. They painted this over once because, I don't know, the people thought it was ugly with all the graffiti and everything. So they painted it over, and within like a month, it looked like this again.
Yeah.
This is actually better this time.
Yeah.
There's some cooler stuff, like that whole wall over there is really cool.
It's always been a kind of a creative area. So many different influences there, all different races. I grew up, when I went to school, I had almost every race in my little school where I was growing up in Venice. And you get all these influences, and musically too. It's a very creative place.
This has been here since probably 1915 or, you know, maybe 1910. All these pilings all across the street. Yeah. Same buildings, same exact buildings since the 1920s, 1910 probably.
And this is where our album, this is where we're walking, you know, the poster.
Yeah.
That's right there.
Alright, I see some.
which is a two,
it's two
quiet. One quiet day, that would be alright. I see some night, someday, that would be alright.
Van de Eagles voor het eerst de stad hier binnen reed, zag hij een gebouw dat hij herkende van de singeltjes die hij vroeger als kind draaide. Capitol Tower van het gelijknamige platenlabel Capitol Records. Henley was intens gelukkig bij het zien van dat gebouw en hij wist dat deze stad alles te maken had met muziek. Deze stad is vergeven van plekken met een muziekhistorische achtergrond, zoals de beroemde Hollywood Bowl, waar in 1964 de Beatles een aantal concerten met een zeer beperkte geluidsinstallatie over het hysterisch krijzend publiek probeerden te spelen. Het geeft een bijzonder gevoel om zomaar op een doordeweekse ochtend over dit podium heen te wandelen, waar werkelijk alle grootheden uit de muziekgeschiedenis wel eens optraden. Hier speelde Jimi Hendrix in het voorprogramma van de Monkees en gaven onder andere Elton John, Santana en Bob Dylan uitverkochte concerten. De Doors. Voor hun was Venice Beach de thuisbasis. Hier in Duke's Coffee Shop begonnen ze in 1965 hun muzikale carrière. Ze speelden er 6 avonden per week voor $5 per persoon. Van dat geld konden Jim Morrison en Ray Manzarek hun studie aan de Filmacademie betalen. Nog altijd ademt deze sobere Amerikaanse koffiebar muziek uit. De wanden zijn volgehangen met foto's en memorabilia van de vele artiesten die de zaak ooit bezochten. Of Jackson Browne hier wel eens een slappe Amerikaanse beker koffie dronk, is niet zeker. Zijn muziek klinkt hier in ieder geval regelmatig. Zijn muzikale carrière is nauw verweven met de muziekgeschiedenis van L.A.
My older brother started playing Jackson Browne records, and he was a big influence on me, you know, with his lyric writing and his attention to the way he describes emotions and things. As I was growing up, when I was in my teens, listening to that kind of music, it really, really influenced me a lot to dig deeper when I'm writing a song and not just say the typical, I love you, you love me, let's go out tonight, you know. I didn't want to do that stuff, and I saw that there are ways of describing emotions. You have to find your own way of doing that.
I don't know what happens when people die. I can't seem to grasp it as hard as I try. Like a song I can hear playing right in my ear, and I can't sing. I can't help listening. And I can't help feeling stupid standing around. Crying is the easier down. 'Cause I know that you'd rather we were dancing. Dancing our sorrow away. Right on dancing.
No matter what fate chooses you play. That you've been shown by everyone you've ever known. Until the dance becomes your very own, no matter how close to yours another steps have grown.
In the end there is one dance you'll do alone.
When I work with him now, it's kind of a joke between Jackson and me because we look so much alike, and I you know, it's nothing I do on purpose. This is the hair I have, and that's the voice I have. I don't try and sound like him, but people always think I'm his little brother, and we always laugh about it.
Keep a fire for the human race. Let your prayers go drifting into space. You never know what will be coming down. Perhaps a better world is drawing near, and just as easy it could all disappear, along with whatever meaning you might have found. Don't let the uncertainty turn you around.
The world keeps turning around and around. Into a dancer you have grown. From a seed somebody else has thrown. Go on ahead and throw some seeds of your own. And somewhere between the time you arrive and the time you go,
may lie the reason you were alive, but you'll never know.
I've used harmonies, you know, I've always known guys that could sing really well, and I, For a Dancer, for instance, they're singing the parts, they're singing similar parts to what was done by Don Henley and Dan Fogelberg and J.D. Souther on that song, and Doug Haywood, I believe, was also on those sessions. So they do that in their sleep, they can do that really quite easily. I don't have that many vocalists to take on the road, so I don't really do that in the studio anymore. I don't really put really, you know, big harmonies. I tend to use two part. Sometimes if I had a third part, you know, it's something that I can do, so I don't do it that much anymore. But it's a pleasure when I see them, it's a pleasure when we get together to do that, because they have that, you know, that power, and they've got that, the resource of, you know, getting to sing that way. So last year we played in this couple concerts together and had a great time singing. I mean, it would be interesting to do something with them in the studio, but then of course it would be, you know, it'd be there. It'd be that done that way, and it would be the song, you know. I have to find a song that I don't mind doing differently live than I on the record, because you can't, unless they want to join my band, you know.
Maar de kans dat Venice op tournee zal gaan met Jackson Browne is klein. Ze zijn voorlopig druk met hun eigen carrière en toerden met hun busje al verschillende malen dwars door de Verenigde Staten.
Oh,
What? The first day of our tour, we jump in the car, we just get on the freeway, go, I can't wait to get home. And everybody laughs because it's a joke, you know. It's the first day of the tour, you're like, I want to go home, I'm bored, you know. So that's like a joke that we have.
6-1-0-2.
Sorry.
It's always tough sometimes to get back in a van with seven other guys and, you know, be on the road all day going to the next show. But once you get backstage and the excitement builds and you can hear the audience out there and you get to go out and play your music and make people dance, make them cry, make them, you know, clap their hands, whatever they want to do. There's just an excitement there that's like nothing else that makes you just carry on that next day. Makes you wake up that next morning and get back in the van and go to the next town because you know you're going to at least touch some of those people.
Oh, good song. Yeah, I remember that. That's one of my favorites. Yeah.
Yeah, it's as good as that other one.
Musician.
Have a good show.
Have a good show.
Yeah.
Like some brilliant moment, at least a few of them, where something happens that's a little different, or maybe even it's a drum fill, or it's a, like last night we had our percussionist Kevin Ricard there, one of our percussionists, and he just added so much. And it's looking over at Michael sometimes when I see in his face this joy of the joy of playing, and he's looking around at Kevin and he looks over at me like, did you hear that? So those moments I can't really pick out like a specific, or like a moment when Kip or Marky will look over at me and we just kind of like laugh and like, look what we're doing. This is great. You know, this is really fun.
Love the one you're with. Love the one you're with. Oh, yeah. Thank you.
up was all it took. Now it's much too late for me. Take a second look. Let me tell you now. Oh, baby, give me one more chance. Show you that I love you. Won't you please let me back in your heart? Oh, darling, I was blind to let you go. Let you go, baby.
'S Nachts na het optreden rijden we over Sunset Boulevard. Hier staat de Roxy, een belangrijke club waar in 1976 Bob Marley en de Wailers een fantastisch concert gaven. En even verderop de Troubadour, waar Guns N' Roses ontdekt werd, waar John Lennon stomdronken zijn Lost Weekend doorbracht en waar Roger McGuinn en David Crosby besloten om de Birds op te richten. David Crosby, die alle ups en downs van een muziekcarrière aan den lijve ondervonden heeft en als geen ander weet dat succes niet alleen afhankelijk is van talent en dat er meer nodig is om in deze grote stad te kunnen meedraaien.
I've been telling people about him since the first night I heard him. I've told everybody I could find that they were the best. And I, you know, I've tried to help him, but the truth is, you know, fate is so strange and the way the business works is so completely twisted that it'll happen when it's supposed to happen, I suppose. I have faith that it will.
Thank you. eagles circle endlessly, and I sing in silent harmony. We both shall be free.
I think our goal is just to keep doing this, to be able to keep doing this and make enough money that like Pat doesn't have to work as a carpenter, and you know, everybody can pay their bills and we can travel and play for people and come home and make another album and do the same thing. That's one of our main goals. It's just to be part of the music business and to be able to make a good living.
I really think this album is going to be, hopefully will be our big, you know, crossover to at least trying to make some kind of a career out of it. Because I've been doing it for 20 years and it's really tough to make money. You know, and I've had to work otherwise doing, I build furniture and, you know, it's tough to keep both going at the same time.
I wouldn't change it, even though we've been struggling for so many years, I wouldn't change one day of it to make anything go quicker or, you know, it's like, I really feel we're at our time now and everything's perfect and everybody else feels the same way too.
So what's your favorite Venice song?
Depends on what week you ask me. Right now it would be Family Tree because it's a very personal in our lives right now. I had an uncle that recently passed away and have had a lot of the older relatives in our family have been passing on, and it's just been good therapy for us to write that song and to finish that song, because it's about letting go of people in your family, but knowing that the family tree will always grow. And we have I have a baby due in May. I have a 3.5-year-old, and we're carrying the torch for the family and the, you know, family tradition. And so that song is probably my favorite right now.
From the earth we rise. We'll keep a candle burning for the ones we'll miss. And when we say goodbye to one of our own, we may be lonely, but we're not alone. Though the leaves will fall and the tears will flow, may it always comfort us to know the tree will always grow stronger than the wind can blow. The family tree will thank you.